In this last video on compiler techniques for high ILP, I'll focus on the topic of memory dependencies. Okay, so let's go back to the same example I had before, where I was loading something into R1 from an address sitting in R2, and there's a store before that, which is writing something into a location specified in R4. Okay, and what I want to do is I want to move the load as early up in the program because I know this is a long latency load, and I'd like to bring the value in well before it's actually used. So my compiler examines this code. It sees that there are no register dependencies, and so it moves the load higher up. So the new code becomes like this. Okay, and then I have the branch, and the branch is really not very important in this example, but I'll just retain it over here. Okay, so as I said, there are no compiler dependencies or no compiler detected register dependencies, and so this should be safe. Okay, but now let's look at my data memory. I have a location sitting here in memory, and its address is, let's say, ABC, and it has the value 50 sitting over here. Okay, let's say that as you're executing this code, and let's look at the original code first, it turns out that R4 happens to contain the value ABC, that is, it's pointing to the same location. And let's say that R3 happens to contain the value 70. So when I execute the store, I'm going to put the value 70 in over here, right? So the 50 becomes 70. And then later when I do the load, again, it so happens that R2 contains the address ABC. So I load from here and I put 70 into this register. Okay, so I should be leaving this point in the program with the value 70 sitting in R1. Now let's look at this new code over here, right? So again, R2 is going to match ABC. So the first thing I'm doing is bringing the value in ABC into R1. And at first, the value in ABC was 50. So I'm leaving this, so when I finish this code, the register R1 will have the value 50. Because the store comes later and changes this 50 into a 70. Okay, so essentially in my original code, there was a write into that location and then a read from that location. So this is a read after write data dependence, which means that if I were to flip the ordering of these two instructions, I will proceed with the wrong result. Okay, so remember when we talked about data dependencies before, we said that when somebody writes something into R1, and then when you read something from R1, that's a read after write register data dependence or register data hazard. And because of this, we were very careful to introduce stall cycles in our pipeline to make sure that the read happened after the write. Okay, so we were disallowing any kind of reordering of these two instructions, right? And the hardware was able to detect this by introducing stall cycles. And the compiler was careful to make sure that it didn't move the second instruction above the first instruction. Okay, but now what we have here is a memory data hazard where you have a store which writes something into a given memory location and then a load which is also reading from that same memory location. So this is an example of a read after write memory data hazard. And we should not be reordering these two instructions as well. Okay, so how can the compiler figure out that there is a memory data hazard, right? When we were dealing with register data hazards, those register data dependencies were being encoded in the names of the registers, right? I could look at R1 and I could know that there was a register data dependence. And that's why I would not move instructions up or down. In this case, the memory dependence is encoded not in the register names, but in the contents of these register entries, right? If you look at the names, they're completely different. But the fact that they both contain the same value, that R4 contains ABC and R2 contains ABC, is the one that creates the memory data dependence. Okay, so at compile time, the compiler is just going to look at the register names, conclude that they're different. But since it has no idea about the contents of the registers, it actually cannot figure out memory data dependencies at compile time. Because the contents of R4 and R2 depend on, you know, whatever inputs the program may have received and whatever is being computed on the fly. Right? So since it does not know about memory data dependencies, the compiler has one of two options before it. One is to be conservative and assume that every load and store might depend on each other, right? Because there's a small chance that the value sitting in R4 and R2 might match. And so the compiler says, well, I'll never move a load above a prior store. if we were to adopt that approach, then the compiler has few options because loads and stores are very common in the program. Okay, they occur very frequently, which means that a load can probably not be moved up by more than a few instructions. Okay, so you know that wouldn't help us maximize our performance. So instead, we look at option two, and what does that do? Let's walk through an example again. Okay, so my new code would become something like this, where I have a load.s. I'm letting my compiler be aggressive. I'm letting it move instructions before a prior store. But if there's a memory dependence, I'm going to try and detect this at runtime. Okay, so my new code will look like this. Just as before, I now have a sentinel instruction, which is later down in the code. And now when I execute the load, the hardware recognizes that this is a speculative load. Okay, this load has been moved up. So I have a special table, which in some architectures is called the advanced load address table. So every time I have a load that is being executed in advance, the address that I fetch from is being recorded in this table. So if this matches ABC, this table will now record the fact that the value fetched in R1 from address ABC is a speculative load. Later, when I execute any store, I look at the address that I'm storing into. In this case, that address is ABC. Now I have to go and check my ALAT table and see if there's a match. So in this case, I detect that this ABC matches the ABC that I had previously fetched from, which means that advanced load has moved ahead with a possibly wrong value. So I put an X over here saying that I just invalidated that advanced load. Later, when I get to this check instruction, I'm going to look at the entry for R1, and I realize that this invalidation has happened. So I jump to my recovery code, which might re-execute the load, get the correct value, and it might also re-execute any dependence of the load, which might have also been moved earlier up. Okay, if the store had been to ABCD, then this check mark would not have been there, and the check instruction would have said that this has succeeded, the advanced load has succeeded, and I can move on with the correct values already sitting in R1. Okay, so this is how I handle memory dependences with an additional table which detects memory dependence violations on the fly. Okay, so when we got to this entire topic of compiler techniques for ILP, we said that our goal over here was to try and maximize performance without putting too much onus on the hardware, right? So we said that we should keep the hardware simple, and let's leave it up to the compiler to reorder instructions and hide stall cycles and maximize performance. Okay, but as we've moved along, we've said that there are certain limitations on what the compiler can do. Okay, and to overcome those limitations, you need techniques like predication, or in this case, an ALAT table to detect memory dependencies. And all of these put onus back on the hardware, right? So you need a table like this in this case, and you need to do a check every time you do a store. You also need techniques like predication, which increases the register file ports, or they increase the pressure on your bypassing circuits and so on, right? So ultimately, if you want really high performance, it is really hard to do that with purely compiler techniques. You ultimately need some hardware support as well. Okay, so we've almost come full circle in some sense, right? So what this means is if you want really high performance, you do need to resort to techniques that are somewhat hardware intensive. And so starting with the next video, we look at these hardware intensive techniques which require almost no support from the compiler. Okay, so these are techniques like out of order execution. Okay, but if you want to really keep the hardware simple, then there's only so much additional performance that you can get. And you know, hence these compiler-based techniques are restricted to domains such as embedded process, where you don't really need the ultimate highest performance, but you want to keep the hardware really simple. Okay, so starting with the next video, we'll look at more hardware-intensive techniques.